It is 12/10/2009. It's 11:07 a.m. Corporal Eric Edwards, Orange County Sheriff's Office, in an interview room at John Young and 50 with, can you state your name for me, please, sir?
Brett Douglas Reilly.
And joining us in a minute will be Sergeant John Allen. Brett, can you raise your right hand for me? Do you swear everything you say today is going to be true?
I do.
Okay. Brett, you're here today regarding your involvement in assisting with the for Kaylee Anthony. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. Your name was brought to our attention from doing other interviews that you may have assisted Texas EquiSearch. I think it was Brett Churchill that originally brought your name to my attention. And then also Carolyn Todd, I think there was an issue with a check or something when you joined Texas EquiSearch. So your name has come up quite several times. That's why we called you. Did you in fact search the area of Suburban during any of those coordinated or uncoordinated searches?
I did not get involved with the coordinated searches for TES. I was assigned to other areas, but in the absence of TES, when they left both the first time and the second time, yes, we went down into the Suburban area.
Okay, when you say we, who were you with?
Richard Crickey, Cindy Brennan, and some of the, I guess at the time, I didn't realize it, but connected to the Gail St. John's psychic group. Basically, I think they call them the SOS team or something, but Richard and I kind of took them under our wings to try and get them, if they were going to do searching, to do it with Texas EquiSearch standards. In other words, you know, have some type of command and control and all of that.
Did, were you ever down there with a Lori Cree or a Brett Churchill or any of that group?
Brett Churchill, I do believe. Laura Crickey, yeah, she was part of the SOS group there.
Okay. Now, when we're talking about Suburban, we're talking about more down towards the school, or did you actually search up where the recovery was made?
We never actually, our group never actually got up to that area. What we were doing is, because it was so wet after it was Tropical Storm Fay, is that area was just flooded. And so we were starting at the areas that were a little higher level and working back towards as they dried out.
Okay.
And so we started down right at that dead end where the school was, and we went into the woods, and we'd go and pull out. Now, during a certain time frame, that area was fenced off. Somebody fenced off both sides of the street. I don't know if it was a contractor or somebody, but we didn't have the ability to get in there without, you know, trespassing, basically.
Okay.
So we would go down there and look, and eventually the fences disappeared again. And so we were able to go back in and start searching.
That's down towards the school.
It started at the school and started heading up toward the housing area on Suburban on both sides.
You know where the wood fence is behind the house right there on the corner?
Mm-hmm.
How far did that fence come along over there?
I'm trying to remember. I don't think it came all the way to that area, but that particular area behind the house was the one that, it was the last one that we wanted to search because it was still wet. I mean, that was swamp area at the time. And so we were systematically moving up toward that area.
Did you ever watch a foot search in that area or a canine deployment in that area?
Negative.
Okay. So knowing what you know today, that area that we spent all the time in recovering the child's remains, you had no part in any search there?
No.
Okay. Did you see standing water in that area?
Yes, I did.
Okay. And do you know what date that was approximately, or what dates?
I would tell you that we started watching it right after Hurricane Fay, or the Tropical Storm Fay. And we would go down, and, you know, I have a friend that lives on Grenadine, so I used to go down there anyway. And I would drive by it just to check to see where the water levels were and how dry it really was. But I would say every 2 to 3 weeks, we would go down and somebody would check it.
And never any luck?
Well, no. I mean, checking meant we were driving down the street to see the conditions. We weren't actually going in to search it. The weekend after Kaylee was found was the weekend that Richard Crickey and I were planning on getting the team together to go into that area, because we had finally deemed it dry enough that we could go in. And you guys beat us to the punch.
Roy Crunk beat us to the punch.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. You had said You were assisting Texas Equisearch, I believe you had told me,
mm-hmm.
Possibly in November.
Correct.
Moving equipment. Can you tell me about that again?
After Texas EcuSearch called the search, they had some equipment that they were going to leave for people who were going to work for TES here in Florida. It wasn't an organized thing, but they left some equipment so that we could use it. And one of them was a laser printer, a big one. And it was broken, but it could be fixed. They asked me to haul it over to somebody's house because it was rather large and I drive a large SUV. And I did that, and while I was there, I met somebody who I was told was the best friend of Casey Anthony growing up.
And whose house were you at?
Gary Greenberg.
Okay. And he was with a TS?
He was with TES. He was TES.
Excuse me.
He was with administrative, what we call black shirt. He had one of the black TES shirts.
And at his house was this girl?
In the garage or the driveway next to his house, they were playing. But I don't know if they just cleared out because we were bringing our stuff in through his driveway and they just moved to the side. But that's where I met her, is kind of in between his condo and the condo next to it.
What was her name?
I believe it was Christina.
And you talked to her directly?
I talked to her directly.
And what did she tell you?
I asked her if she was really a good friend of Casey's, where she would hang out, where she thought we should be searching. And the one area that she brought up to us was the area where Kaylee was ultimately found, which was that corner right there off Suburban and at the end of the school. I forget, that was at Hope Spring, the other road.
Did she say why she would search there?
She said that that's where they spent a lot of time as younger kids. That was where they would bury their pets. That's an area that she thought that Casey knew very well.
Is this the same girl that did the story with the, I think it was the Globe?
I don't know. I'm not familiar with the story of the Globe.
Do you know if she is, did she talk to, you know, if she's the same girl that talked to Casey on the phone after Casey was arrested?
I said I don't know. I mean, I know what she looks like from having seen her, but as far as, you know, the case, I mean, I haven't really kept up with every individual character, I guess you would call them, in the case.
What was her opinion of the babysitter issues?
Her opinion was that she was the babysitter. She told me, she goes, you know, I took care of Kaylee, basically, and that her two children were very upset that Kaylee was never coming back.
Christina had two children?
Correct.
Did Christina ever say she met anybody named Zanny the Nanny or Zanani Gonzalez?
No, she laughed about that. That's what that was all about. She was like, I was the nanny. That's what she told me.
Okay.
And did she stress an opinion regarding what Casey was capable of, or if capable of this at all, or did she have any insight in that regard?
No, she didn't discuss, you know, what her opinions were on whether Casey had done it or not done it. She just told me, hey, if this is the area you're going to look at, go take a look at that one.
It just strengthened your desire to go back there when it was dry.
Correct.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, now, something to think about it, it was because of that conversation that I brought up with Richard Crickey that was a key area that we needed to go back to. And we started really checking it for how dry it was. And the week that before you guys found Kaylee, Richard and I had talked about a couple areas that we wanted to get some of the TES volunteers who were still willing to search to go to. And one of them was Soldier Creek Park up in, I guess, near Seminole. And the other one was the Suburban Drive area.
Did you ever get to go down there and do that? Or
no.
That was just in the planning phases?
That was in the planning phase, because what we were doing is we would go out and do a search one weekend, and then we'd figure out where we're going during that week, and then the next weekend we would meet somewhere, and then we would go search that.
Now, would you keep track of who was involved in those searches as if it was an EquiSearch thing? Or?
Bill Fitzgerald would be the guy you need to talk to.
Okay. And does he currently have that paperwork that you're aware of? Or you don't know? Okay.
Totally unaware.
Now that we're talking about paperwork, did you ever serve as a team leader or fill out paperwork as a team leader for EquiSearch?
Yes, I did.
Do you remember the dates?
I can tell you pretty much all of the second search almost every day.
Every day you served as a team. What areas were you assigned as a team leader?
One of them was at Eagle's Nest school down off of, I'm trying to name it, the area, down there, L.B. McLeod Road and all of that. That was one area. There were a couple different areas. I think more my focus, at least on the first day, was for the Jennifer Kessie case, I think. We went into areas where there were a lot of homeless, and they wanted some strong guys who knew what they were doing to go into some of these more dangerous areas.
What was your base camp for that search? Where were we all meeting for that, right?
That was Judge Road.
Okay.
The Cayley 2 search, when the Texas Ecu search came back, it was out near the airport, behind like the
industrial park where they had all the trailers and stuff set up. That one, or
That was the first one.
That was the very first one.
That was the first search. Okay. That was the one that was off Lee Vista.
Right.
Now, well, the other one was too. If you kept going down Lee Vista past Semoran, and then I think that's on the other side. It's called Judge Road, and it goes around the corner
on the east or west side of 436.
Yeah.
Okay. So it wasn't the one where they were at the Days Inn, or the Holiday Inn rather, where Brett worked.
Yeah, I was in.
You were in that one too.
I was involved every time that TES came down here, except for one. But the two main searches we call Cayley 1, and the second one was Cayley 2. And I think the second one was in November, and then there was the early one that was in the end of summer, I believe.
Let me finish up the paperwork things then, and then we'll come back to the other search. What would you do on those forms? What was your responsibility?
The forms were responsible for making sure that we had the command center phone number, that we had the grid on the map that we were searching, the names and phone numbers of every searcher that was in our team.
Okay.
And generally it would have a brief description of what we were looking at on that piece of paper. And then down at the bottom, there would be like a small section where you could write a small debrief set of information at the bottom.
The name Doug keeps coming up for debriefs. Do you know Doug's last name? Are you familiar with that name?
Doug. I'm trying to think, because the person I debriefed with was Bill Todd a lot. I specifically would wait for him.
And you would give him all that paperwork at the time?
Mm-hmm.
My understanding is Bill Todd looks a lot like Tim Miller.
Yes.
So Bill Todd, you gave paperwork, and where would that paperwork go from there? Do you have any idea?
It would stay there.
There?
They would take it and put it in a stack, and, you know, of course, you would sign it and, you know, basically let them know what you searched, what you didn't search, what you found, you know, those types of things.
Now, those articles out there that you guys would flag, I guess, that's where they would determine who would get sent back out to check on those things?
I don't know if they would use those so much to determine who. All it was to determine that it did or didn't need to be searched
again. Needed to be searched again.
Correct.
Okay. The search, the not 1, 2, 3, but the one that occurred there in the middle at the Days Inn, where they also did a Kessie search.
Mm-hmm.
You with me on the weekend? You remember when that was?
I'm trying to think.
Kind of the unlabeled search?
No, because I don't. I know that they were there through Richard Crickey, but I didn't actively take part in that one.
Okay.
The one that I took part of, now I'm stopping to think, it was the beginning of Cayley 2, where they were at where Brett Churchill worked.
Okay.
Then they moved it down to that command center. That's
okay.
Really what happened.
Fair enough. So we don't know who Doug is yet. I'm sure Bill Fitzgerald can help me identify Doug.
Now, did they give you any description of Doug? He was just a...
Balding, glasses, was mapping, and he was from Texas.
Balding, glasses, mapping from Texas.
We can find out. It's not that big.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember, because I remember Brett Churchill pretty much was doing most of the mapping, and he's one that I dealt with a lot. On the mapping side.
Anyone else that we need to be aware of that may have searched that area that was a team leader that that we would like to speak with?
No, I think Richard Cricky, Tim Miller, those guys are the key members. They kept a lot of that stuff close to the vest.
Joe Jordan? Do you ever see Joe Jordan in the area?
I believe that they went with us one time, and we didn't go up to the, you know, where they found Kaylee. It was back toward the school again. One of the things I will tell you is with Richard Cricky, we would walk up and down the street when we go down there, and I don't know if you know about the guy. The guy's like a human cadaver dog. The guy knows the difference between animal decomp and human decomp because he works in a mortuary and all of that. He tells me that he gets, like, you know, when you bite into a sour lemon, how you get that area right behind your ears where it just gets really, you know, funky. When he smells human decomp, he gets that. And walking up toward that area on Suburban Drive while it was still wet, he told me, he said, yeah, I'm getting that feeling right there. Huh. So
we're going to interview him next, so we'll ask him about the sensation.
Yeah.
Cricky, you said?
Richard Cricky. Okay. Yes, sir.
Did you ever turn any paperwork into somebody named Brad Dennis, or did you ever meet anybody named Brad Dennis?
Brad Dennis. You know, the name is familiar. There again. But, yeah, I mean, the Texas Psyche Search would have a lot of people. They're bringing in people from Texas, and they would sit and be the administrative people. And so when you got there, most people had never seen them before unless you were an actual, you know, longtime member of Texas AccuSearch. So I may have met this person, but I wouldn't know by name.
Were there primary canine handlers that they would have come out and assist you guys who, you know, they're by name?
The only one I remember is a guy named David, and he was the one that had Dixie, the pooping cadaver dog. And I actually saw him on another search. Brett Churchill and a couple of the TES people, Tony Vervinsky, we all went up to North Carolina and did a search for Muay Thai. And this group that David belonged to, his group pretty much ran a search up there. And so I saw him up there as well. And I also saw him, he did come down from South Carolina for the other search, the Haley Cummings search.
Is that where David's from, in South Carolina?
I believe so.
And did you ever see him deploy his... You never saw any dogs deployed in that area?
Not in that area.
Okay. All right.
That's it.
Raise your right hand for me. You swear that everything you said today is true?
I do.
It's currently 11:25. Same individual in the room.